Hi, this is Liz Bradley. I'm a professor in the Computer Science Department at the University of Colorado at Boulder, and also on the external faculty of the Santa Fe Institute. My research interests are in nonlinear dynamics and chaos, and in artificial intelligence. And I'm going to be your guide during this course on nonlinear dynamics and chaos. Here's an example of a nonlinear dynamical system. It's a double pendulum, two pieces of aluminum and four ball bearings. Even though the system is physically very simple, its behavior is very complicated. Moreover, this system is sensitively dependent on initial conditions. If I start it here or here, the future evolution of the behavior will be very different. Even though the behavior of that device is very, very complicated, there are some very strong patterns in that behavior. And the tandem of those patterns and the sensitivity is the hallmark of chaos. Now, there's lots of words on this slide that we'll get into over the next 10 weeks. I'll just give you some highlights here. A deterministic system is one that is not random. Cause and effect are linked, and the current state determines the future state. A dynamic system, or dynamical system, either are fine, is a system that evolves with time. A nonlinear system is one where the relationships between the variables that matter are not linear. An example of a nonlinear system is the gas gauge in a car, at least in my car, where I fill up the tank and then I drive 100 miles and the needle barely moves. And then I drive another 100 miles and the needle plummets. That's a nonlinear relationship between the level of gas in the tank and the position of the needle. Now, nonlinear dynamics and chaos are not rare. Of all the systems in the universe that evolve with time, that's the outer ellipse in this Venn diagram, the vast majority of them are nonlinear. Indeed, a famous mathematician refers to the study of nonlinear dynamics as the study of non-elephant animals. Now, this is somewhat problematic because the traditional training that we get in science, engineering, and mathematics uses the assumption of linearity, and that's only a very small part of the picture. Now, looking at the inner two ellipses on this Venn diagram conveys the point that the majority of nonlinear systems are chaotic, and so that's going to play a big role in this course. And the equations that describe chaotic systems cannot be solved analytically, that is, with paper and pencil. Rather, we have to solve them with computers. And that's a large part of what distinguishes this course on nonlinear dynamics and chaos from most other courses on this topic area, including Steve Strogatz's great lectures, which are on the web, and the courses on the Complexity Explorer website about this topic. We will focus not only on the mathematics, but also on the role of computation in the field. In this field, the computer is the lab instrument. This is experimental mathematics. And that's actually why the field of nonlinear dynamics only took off 3 or 4 decades ago. Before that, there weren't computers to help us solve the equations. Now, to succeed in this course, you'll need to understand the notion of a derivative, because dynamical systems are about change with time, and derivatives are the mathematics of change with time. You'll also need to be able to write simple computer programs. Basically, to translate simple mathematics formulas into code, run them, and plot the results, say on the axes of, you know, x versus t. There is no required computer language. You can use whichever programming language you want. And you're not going to turn in your code in this course. We're interested in the results that come out of it. You'll also need to know about basic classical mechanics, the stuff that you get in first semester physics, like pendulums and masses on springs and bodies pulling on each other with GMM over R squared kinds of forces. Speaking of GMM over R squared, you may have seen this movie in the promo video that I made. This is a movie taken by a camera on the Cassini spacecraft as it flew by Saturn's moon Hyperion. Hyperion is a very unusual shape, and as a result of that shape, it tumbles chaotically. There's also chaos in how planets move through space, not just how they tumble. You may remember from physics that the solutions in those cases can only be conic sections, ellipses, parabolas, and hyperbolas. As we will see, systems with three or more bodies can be chaotic. Now think about it. How many bodies are there in the solar system? Lots more than two. Indeed, several hundred years ago, the King of Sweden issued the challenge of a large cash prize to the person who could prove whether or not the solar system was stable in the long term. And that prize was never claimed, but the answer appeared in the 1980s. Indeed, the solar system is chaotic, although it is stable in a sense, and we'll get back to that. So just some brief history of our field. It really dates back to Henri Poincaré in the late 1800s, but it really got going in the 1960s with Ed Lorentz's paper called Deterministic Non-Periodic Flow. Lorentz was the first person to recognize the patterns of chaos and the sensitivity of the evolution of the system within the context of those patterns. In the 70s, this paper by Lee and York was the first to use the word chaos in conjunction with this behavior. In the late 70s and 80s, the chaos cabal at the University of California at Santa Cruz got very interested in nonlinear dynamics, and one of the problems that they approached it with was trying to beat roulette, that is, modeling the path of a ball on a roulette wheel and using that information to advantage. After this, things really took off. And I should say, of course, that I'm only cherry-picking a very small number of examples by lots of smart people in a very active field. Nonlinear dynamics turns up all over the place. Imagine an eddy in a creek, so a patch of swirling water on the surface of a creek or river. You could imagine dropping a wood chip in that patch of water and watching its path from above, perhaps with a camera, and then dropping another wood chip in that eddy at a slightly different point and watching its path. Those paths, they would trace out the patches of swirling water in that eddy in different order. But if you did a time-lapse photograph of their paths, they would both trace out the same eddy. Weather is nonlinear and chaotic. You may have heard of the butterfly effect. A butterfly flapping its wings, setting off a hurricane, a week later, 1,000 miles away. Again, small change, large effect, sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Marine invertebrates actually make use of chaotic mixing in the water around them during spawning. And I'm interested in exploiting chaotic mixing to design better fuel injectors in cars. Nonlinear and chaotic dynamics also turns up in driven nonlinear oscillators, like the pendulum that I showed you, like the human heart, which is normally kind of mostly periodic, but can go into a chaotic state called ventricular fibrillation. And as you saw with the example of Hyperion, there's a lot of nonlinear and chaotic dynamics in classical mechanics, ranging from the three-body problem to how black holes move around each other. And nonlinear and chaotic dynamics turns up in lots and lots of other fields, including certainly things that you are interested in. So as I hope you can see, nonlinear and chaotic dynamics are not an academic oddity. They are widespread, and they are fascinating, and I hope that you will get infected by some of that fascination over the course of the next 10 weeks. There are other fascinating courses on the Complexity Explorer website, including Dave Feldman's course on this same topic area that only assumes knowledge of high school algebra, and Melanie Mitchell's wonderful course on complexity. The difference between complexity and chaos actually bears a little bit of explanation. Put perhaps too simply, you can think of chaos as complicated behavior from simple systems, like my pendulum, and you could think of complexity science as addressing systems that are very complicated but have simple behavior. Again, that's too pat, but the idea is generally right. So, 1,000 fish forming a single school. Now, some logistics. There are several thousand of you and one of me. We have an email address for this course, but it can very rapidly get overwhelmed. Please do not use my own personal email address or that of the TA for course-related communication. That thousands to one ratio is one of the major issues with MOOCs like this one. Part of the way we plan to work around that is with an electronic forum. This is not just to take a load off the course staff, it's also to solve one of the other problems with MOOCs, which is instead of being in a traditional classroom, everyone taking this course is working by themselves all over the world in all sorts of time zones. And we hope to use the forum to help with that. So if you have a question, look on the forum. Someone else may have posted that question already. If not, post it yourself. If someone has posted an answer, look at that answer. If you see a question that you know the answer to, or you think you do, offer your answer. I'll also use the forum, by the way, to post announcements like, there's a bug in the problem set, or I've just posted a whole new unit, or the New York Times has an article about the stuff that I just talked about. I'll also post discussion questions and answers for topics that may interest some people in the course. If somebody wants to go deeper into something or sideways along a tangent, that's where the forum can play a role. Here's another piece of technology that can help. There's no textbook for this course. I'm pulling together material from many, many different sources, including a substantial amount from my own work, papers that I've read, talks that I've heard at conferences, and so on and so forth. These video lectures are short, self-contained summaries of each topic. I use this supplemental materials page to supplement those summaries. So if you want to dig more deeply into something I mention, or if you'd like some background material, or you want to read the original paper that I mentioned, this is where you should look. In the next segment of this course, we'll start digging into some ideas and mathematics and plots and computer examples. Most of my video lectures, by the way, will not be quite as long as this one. We had a lot to cover today. And there will be a short quiz after most of my video lectures, a way for you to road test your understanding of the material. Those will not be graded. At the end of each unit, of which there are 10, there will be a unit test. Those are graded electronically, and that grade will be the basis of your eligibility for a certificate of completion of this course, if you want one. Some of you may not want a certificate. You may just want to watch the lectures, and that's absolutely fine. This is all here on offer for you to use in the way that best suits you. A word about computers. Functional computer literacy is a prerequisite for this course. If you can't program, you're not going to be able to write the programs that you will need to explore in the homework. Now, I've designed the course so that you can still pass it without doing that, and you can still get a flavor of the concepts. But to get the full experience, you really do need to be able to do the homework. And there will be problems on each exam that depend on your having done the programming for the homework for that unit. You're welcome to use any computer programming language that you wish. Modern computer programming languages are all Turing equivalent, so it shouldn't matter what you use. What's going to matter is what comes out of your code, not the how well commented it is or what style it has. We're interested in what comes out, and that's what we'll be looking for in the exams and the quizzes. Another related and important point, there are thousands of you, and among the thousands of you, there are going to be dozens of favorite programming languages, so there's no way that we'll be able to help you debug your code. You can post on the forum, and your classmates will help you. Please do not just post entire solutions on the forum and ask, where's the bug? We have chosen Matlab as the program in which we will post our solutions because it's pretty widespread and pretty simple. It's a good lingua franca for that purpose. If you've never encountered Matlab, you may want to look over one of the many tutorials that are available on the web for the basic syntax for that language so that you can understand our solutions.